A. Accept the challenge. Congratulations. Since you have selected this book to read, I assume you've already taken care of the first step by choosing to become a parent. Perhaps you are new to this parenting gig and you want to read this book to get off on the right foot. Good for you. Maybe you are several years and multiple kids into this racket already, and you're reading this book to check up on yourself. If that's the case, then let me commend you for having an open mind and not being a know-it-all already. Or maybe you're here because you married someone with children and you are stepping into parenthood from that angle. If so, then bless your heart. I especially admire that you're reading a parenting book. It indicates that you take your new role seriously and not just by default of a matrimonial package deal. You actually want to get this right. No matter what brought you here or what stage of parenting you are in, welcome. Make no doubt about it, parenting is a challenge. If you want to overcome and win at it, then keep reading. You will find some helpful tips and encouragement here to get you through this thing. Acknowledge a higher power. This is not a faith-based book per se, but it is written from my own perspective, based upon my personal experiences and observations. Therefore, since I'm a believer, I get to include this little bit of religiosity. From the time my children were little, they have never left the house without hearing me or their father or both of us say to them, "Remember whose you are." And because of their upbringing, they have always known exactly what that means. Notice the capitalization of the pronoun. That is not a mistake. That is how we reference deity. Parents often tell their children to remember who they are, and there is certainly nothing wrong with that. In fact, I encourage it. It is a reminder to them that they should carry themselves with dignity and never forget that they represent not only themselves, but their family name and the others who wear it as well. The admonishment to remember whose they are, though, takes the expectation to a higher plane. It raises the bar to enforce an even higher standard. It reminds them where they came from and where they're going, and to act accordingly. When you are the child of a king, you know to behave like a prince or a princess. Scripture tells us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Even if you're not a believer in a higher power, I'm willing to bet that you are at least somewhat impressed by the perfect symbiotic intricacies of the human body in its place in the universe. If so, then you may address the issue of acknowledging a higher power from that standpoint. Let your children be in awe of something. It instills healthy doses of both pride and humility. Pride in the knowledge that our very existence illustrates the miraculous in humanity and the knowledge that man had absolutely nothing to do with making it happen. Every person needs this balance of self-awareness. Part of your job as a parent is to help your child to achieve that balance. If you are indeed a believer in God, though, then be aware of your responsibility to nurture your child's spiritual needs. You already know that you must meet their physical needs. Even the law enforces that. Satisfying their innate hunger for their Creator, though, is something that you voluntarily choose to do. Do this and your child can see that you, too, look to a higher authority. By demonstrating your own faith, you help them to develop theirs. If you have ever been through a really rough patch in your life, then you know how vital faith is. Help your children to grow their own. It is a gift that will sustain them for life. Pray with your children. Read the Bible together or whatever holy book you look to. Don't just send them to Sunday school, church, synagogue, or mosque. Go with them. Admit your mistakes, then apologize. This is just a good overall rule to live by. A willingness to say, "I was wrong, please forgive me," will go a long way towards mending the cracks in the seams of any relationship. It is rather hard to do, though. It can be especially hard to make yourself that vulnerable to a child. Do it anyway. Let your child know that you are human and that it is okay to be so. You may be surprised that they will actually admire you for it. Ironic, isn't it? It makes sense, though. Think of someone who has wronged you. Now think of how you would feel if that person never tried to make amends versus how you would feel if they approached you with sincere remorse. You don't mean to tell me that you prefer the former, do you? Of course not. So if by apologizing, a person stands taller in your estimation, Tell me again how apologizing is a humiliating experience. You want your children to own their mess-ups and make them right, don't you? Well, you are going to have to show them how that's done. If you can't do it yourself, you can't very well expect them to. Allowance. The question of paying children has long been debated. Ultimately, every household does what works for them. No matter how you choose to handle the issue of allowances, though, this fact remains. Every child must, at some point, learn about money. He needs to learn the value of a dollar and how to manage money. He needs to learn the concept of delayed gratification by saving up for something he wants. He needs to learn that just because he says, "I want," things don't just magically appear. Things must be paid for. The only way children can learn these lessons is to have some money of their own to practice with. So how do you get that money into their hands without just forking it over for no apparent reason? If you don't teach them the concept that money is earned, then any other lessons regarding money seem kind of pointless. Do you pay kids to do their chores? Here's my take on that. Every child needs to understand that he is a part of a family, a team, and every member has an integral role. Except for the baby, there are no freeloaders allowed. The chores a child does are what he contributes to that team. He needs to know that he is expected to perform these duties with or without pay. This is all part of teaching kids about responsibility and self-discipline. I have no problem with telling a child that his payment for doing his chores is that he has a roof over his head and a bed to sleep in, food to eat, and clothes to wear. We have electricity, running water, television, and internet. Feel free to show him some of the bills versus your paycheck and let him see what a sweet deal he is getting financially. If you want to get some money into his hands, perhaps you can allow payment for the jobs above and beyond their usual duties, or just give him an age-appropriate amount of cash each week to learn with. If he has been particularly unreliable about doing his chores that week, or has been an all-around brat, then by all means, don't give him a dime, and let him know why. You should probably give him a chance to earn it back, but that's up to you. Your child will want to make some unwise purchases. He might save his money for months to buy something you know won't last a day. You can advise him, but resist the urge to stop him. This is also a valuable lesson that requires money to learn. The item he buys may not be worth it, but the lesson is.